thanks for announcing my talk on the Atiyah conjecture. thank you for having me around. I have studied L2 invariants when I wrote my diploma thesis already, which is a long, long time ago, so it's good to come back to it. I'm nervous as always when I'm giving talks, or if I have given some. If you feel I'm too fast or too slow or too something, just cry and ask questions. Most of the time one is too fast rather than too slow, as I know. And yeah, you're going to measure me on how many new trends are going to appear. We'll see. So the content is now fixed, so about that I can't do much, but I could try to. You stop me if I'm too fast. Okay. I want to talk about algebraic consequences of, or relations, algebraic algebra of group rings versus algebra of L2 Betti numbers. What we've seen before, and so recall. Let me fix a group discrete group gamma. Then we saw this morning L2 Betti numbers defined, and I'm going to do it again in the following context. Fix the discrete gamma and a free co-compact gamma CW complex X tilde. This means that on X tilde, this group gamma acts freely and cellularly, and then we can pass to the quotient, and this quotient is a compact CW complex X. It's a compact W complex, and it has this X tilde as a certain covering space of it, and we lift then the cell structure next to this X tilde, and gamma acts. Okay, so good so far. Then there is the cellular chain complex, or code chain, we could take both. Let me take the chain complex of X tilde, see not. So there is the P chains on X tilde and the cell and the boundary map, because I'm doing homology, the map to the P minus 1 chains on X tilde and so on. And so far there is no L2. These are just the finite chains, finite sums of formal sums of cells. And we see that on this the group gamma acts, and the differential is compatible with this gamma action. And let's introduce, as you've seen this morning, let's introduce coordinates. Let's try to compute these groups. Well, of course, these are free abelian groups, as we all know, but they're slightly better. They are free Z gamma modules, finely generated free Z gamma modules. So we have some Z gamma to the, NP here. And here we have some Z gamma to the NP minus 1 here. And these isomorphisms are not completely arbitrary. We just choose them. So these are gamma isomorphisms. Gamma acts here and acts here. That's really an isomorphism of gamma modules. And we obtain these isomorphisms by fixing one cell in each gamma orbit. That will correspond to the one in this module, and then the others you get by translating. So that's what this looks like. And let's also think for a second about when we introduce these coordinates, this basis, how does the differential look like? Well, that's going to be a map of these three Z-gamma modules, and there's only one kind of such maps. The kind of basis elements have to be mapped to something, and the rest is then automatic. And these somethings are elements in here. Each basis is mapped to an element in here, and you describe this by a matrix, as we know from linear algebra 1. So this is given by multiplication with a matrix A, AP, I guess. Let me call it AP, where AP is a matrix over Z gamma, and it acts by matrix vector multiplication, as it should. And of course, I have to write down the size because I never get this wrong. I'm just writing it like that. I never get it right. I leave it like that. Okay, wonderful. So this is kind of leading the way toward this algebra aspect, which is a bit away from this representation theory and analysis aspect we saw this morning. We can complete Z gamma to L2 gamma. And this gives a canonical, so we have a kind of canonical inner product, pre-Hilbert space structure on these things, where the cells are, it's not quite pre-Hilbert space structure, the cells are the basis elements, which also change the scalars from Z to the complex numbers or real numbers, depending on whether you like real or complex vector spaces. So this should be complete, contained in this completion step, first pass from Z to Z to the complex numbers gamma, then to L to gamma, and still AP acts by matrix vector, by matrix vector multiplication. So we will have this L2 of gamma to the NP. As bounded gamma equivariant operators on these Hilbert spaces. That's what we saw this morning, not quite worked out, how you make these Hilbert spaces for these possibly infinite and sort of finite coverings. So here the more interesting cases when gamma is infinite, of course. You have to do the completion only if the group is infinite. Now we can define the L2 Betti numbers. And now, L2 Betti numbers are BPL2 of, well, let me write. I know there's always a question of how you make the notation. Maybe you focus on x, maybe focus on x tilde. Let me focus on x tilde, but let me recall we have this gamma action because it's really the integral part of the definition and the structure. We can use the orthogonal projections onto this harmonic part of the cohomology, which is the complement of the image of dp plus 1 in the kernel of dp. So that's the same thing we saw before. We have this decomposition. We take the kernel part, but out of this we divide the image part, and what's remaining is the complement of that. And there is an orthogonal projection onto that. And this is, again, a gamma invariant or a gamma equivariant operator on this Hilbert space. Here we will be. Of this, we finally have to take this gamma trace, which was mentioned before. Okay, and maybe I should also tell you what the gamma trace is. Remind you what the gamma trace is, where trace gamma of such, now that's going to be another operator from L to gamma to the NP to itself, so which can be described as a matrix of certain things, and this of this projection operator is given by the following expression. We do a sum over the rank of this free Z gamma module, and for each basis element, delta Ej, Ei, I guess, we apply this projection operator to this thing, and then we take the inner product with the same basis element. So these are vectors of the form in this vector space, 0. There is the ith place where it's not 0. And in the ith place, it's the delta function of the identity element. So this formal sum, which is 1 at the identity and 0 everywhere else. These are the standard basis vectors we know and love in Euclidean space. Well, so here we are. These are the L to beta numbers. And note that we don't need the homogeneous space aspect to it. This works for an arbitrary gamma CW complex, at least if it's co-compact, although there is interesting generalizations and important generalizations to more general gamma spaces. This naive definition works for the co-compact free case. So, okay, just one note. This might also, in many cases, works for x being b gamma, x tilde being e gamma, the classifying space for the group. Well, many cases, because sometimes there's no finite CW complex model for that. And the case we saw this morning was essentially that we always have this b gamma around. But I work with general spaces. So if some people talk about L to beta numbers of a group, they only talk about one number in each degree, whereas I talk about all spaces at once. So there's many, many numbers, kind of a different aspect of this L2 cohomology business, not just the group as a classifying space and one invariant for the group, but many, many possibilities because we have many gamma CW complexes. So we look at general X tilde. Yeah, I should. It's true, and I won't go into that now. I will not go into that, but it's true. This is a homotopy invariant for this quotient space, or a gamma equivalent homotopy invariant upstairs. So that's all well defined, provided this can be defined in a naive way. You have the problem that not always this is a finite gamma, finite CW complex. Okay, so more algebra. So the this projector onto this image of dp minus 1 kind of complementary part inside kernel of dp. This particular subspace of L2 gamma to the NP can be rewritten, as you've seen this morning, so actually this is happening on that level, as the kernel of a combinatorial Laplacian, which is dp star plus dp minus 1 dp minus 1 star. And then, of course, I have to take the projector to get this equality right syntax-wise. So these spaces, and this is exactly the same subspace, that's this Hodge theory. Kernel of dp? No, I think. So whatever that symbol means, it means the remaining part of the bigger if you take the complement of the smaller. Okay? There is only one reasonable definition of it you have to make. Well, wonderful. So we can work with these delta p's, these combinatorial Laplacians, which are positive self-adjoint square matrices over Z gamma. Okay, the matrix over Z gamma is clear, and positive self-adjoint is in the sense of operators on the Hilbert space L2 gamma to the NP we saw before. So there is a notion of positive and self-adjoint, and this is exactly one of those, as you can see from this formula. So instead of looking at these kernels and the complement of the image in the kernel, we can look at that, as we saw this morning. And now comes the interesting observation. So that's a little lemma. The possible L2 Betti numbers all P, all X as above for a given group. So maybe I should have fixed the group at the very beginning. For a given group, this set, that's a subset of the real numbers I'm interested in. And we saw that all of these come about as traces of projectors onto kernels of such operators. And any of those can be realized as a differential. So we can go back and forth. This is not a subset, but the same set as the possible values of those kernel dimensions we can see there. So it's the same as the possible L2 gamma traces of these projectors onto the kernels of deltas, where delta ranges over matrices of all possible sizes over the integral grouping. And you can add or drop this self-adjoint and positive there. Still going to be the same set. Okay, so now I can remind you of the Atiyah conjecture. And because there is a huge controversy involving Sir Michael Atiyah himself, he did not make this conjecture. So he just, in his article where he introduces L2 Betti numbers, asks what this set is. And then says, maybe it's only rationals, or maybe even only integers. So he's very careful about not making a conjecture. But if you want to write a research grant, it's nicer if you say, I'm talking about the Atiyah conjecture. So at some point, somehow it turned into the Atiyah conjecture. But I mean, whatever. If LCM of gamma, I define something. This is the least common multiple of a set of natural numbers. Namely, these natural numbers are the sizes of E's, where E in gamma is finite subgroup. So let's make a reality check. What does it mean that LCM of gamma is 1? Right, because the only numbers which should appear here are 1, so there's no finite subgroup at all, and then the group is totally free. That's equivalent. There is a little thing to worry about if there is no bound on the orders of finite subgroups. Then I don't want to talk about that. So let's assume that this is finite, meaning there should be a bound on the orders of finite subgroups, where there's a reasonable number I'm defining here. That's an important player. And once again, if the group is torsion-free, this number is 1. The Atiyah conjecture says, let me give that a name. This is the set of values of L2 Betti numbers for the group gamma. And the Atiyah conjecture says that this is contained in the following abelian subgroup, additive subgroup of the reals, namely the only numbers which come up are rationals And the biggest denominator which comes up is this LCM of gamma. So that is a conjecture. And indeed, you can play a little bit, and we'll see that is equal. This set is then equal to the positive elements in here. It's not hard to see. And what actually, this positive part is always contained in there. So the question is it really this direction? That, this is really the important question. Do these Betti numbers always come up this way? And let me make one remark here. All right. This is quite valuable. This can be valuable because it means some kind of quantization. And I mean, this is a discrete subset of the reals. And let us imagine for a moment that we have a way to compute approximately a certain L2 Betti number, maybe not completely precisely. If we know this is quantized that way, it's sitting in the discrete subset, we have to go on for, if we have enough accuracy of our computation, then we know precisely what the number is. So a sequence inside this thing, which converts to something in here, we know precisely where the limit is if we know the term enough accuracy. But this is a useful observation, which has been used to do calculations of L2 Betti numbers in some cases. Well, okay. So, now I'm... So, what is strong? You could make statements like L2 Betti numbers are always rational. That would be weaker than that. So it's very precise, and that's why it's strong. It is stronger than what Atiyah asked, because he asked, are they always rational? So in that sense, it's strong. He also asked, are they always integers, which he knew himself is not the case, because further up in the paper, he makes a calculation and says it's 1 over the order of a certain group. So he somehow was in the middle between integer and rational, and that's a very good way to express this. I don't know. But one could make weaker conjectures. The weaker ones, or maybe, so like rationality, you can make without having a finite, a bound on the finite order subgroups, but the weaker ones are wrong. There is Łukasz Grabowski who has obtained counterexamples to that, and Tim Austin before that, and others as well. So, but today we're talking about the bright positive side and want to see when this is right and what algebraic consequences this has. So here is a... well, weaker, but for more groups. If you allow arbitrarily big finite order subgroups, that's not covered by this thing, but you could still say rational as a conjecture for the possible values. That's plainly wrong. Yeah. Choose your name. Hasn't been. Yeah. So you could, instead of asking for these L2 Betti numbers being contained in the subgroup, the additive, asking for them being contained in the subring, that would make sense, maybe. But this is in, I mean, for groups where this LCM makes sense as a finite number, we have no counterexample. So let's try to prove this. And if there's a counterexample, let's see whether your conjecture is satisfied or not. But at the moment, let's focus on this. Okay. Linnell proved the Atiyah conjecture is for gamma free groups. For arbitrary free groups and more. And use the following okay, diagram of ring inclusions. And maybe before I do that, I also making another remark. Okay. So there's a cliffhanger that's going to come. But before that, we make another remark. Generalization. And geometry, meaning if we look at cellular chain complexes of CW complexes, this all always gives matrices over Z gamma. That's a fact. If you glue cells together, there's mapping degrees showing up, which are these integers. But otherwise, if we take delta, which is a matrix over the complex group ring, it still will be a nice bounded operator gamma equivariant on L2 gamma to the power. So we will have a trace of the projector onto it, some kind of dimension of the kernel. And it's algebraically an interesting question whether there's a difference between the integers here as coefficients or the complex numbers, or something in between. I mean, you could take any something, field, let's say, subring of the complex numbers as coefficients and ask what are the values we get. Okay? But we should also try to understand for K and C any field from a ring can always pass through a field by adding denominators without changing dimensions of kernels or kernels themselves. What is beta of gamma comma k, which is the traces of the projectors onto the kernels of deltas, these L2 traces, where delta now is a matrix over K gamma. Okay? So if we can, we should try to prove a stronger statement and maybe establish that this a priori bigger set is still contained in 1 over LCM times Z. And that is what Linnell did. Let's see. With the proof of the Artier conjecture with K even equal to the complex numbers, the full thing. And along the way, he used the following ring inclusion. So we can take our K gamma. So recall, this could be Z gamma or Q gamma. Well, if you want to, this is something which is not showing up much, but we can include this into the reduced group disaster algebra of gamma. And what is this? This is, C gamma acting as bounded operators on L2 gamma, the way we saw it before. Now it's just one by one matrices. That's, we make this algebras. So C gamma acts on L2 gamma by bounded operators, by left multiplication. And then we can close it up in norm. That is a favorite player of people doing non-committed geometry and C star index theory and things like that. And it would be nice to ping it into a picture. So I do it. But it will play no further role. And the next thing which is used is the phonomial algebra of gamma, which is also a subset of the bound operators on L2 gamma. But now it's all those which are gamma equivariant for the. Let's say we let this thing act by left multiplication and it's equivariant for the right multiplication, which is also equal to another closure, the weak closure of the complex group ring in the bound operators. So on the bound operators, there are many topologies. The norm topology, maybe even we like most, but we can also do other closures for other topologies. And the weak or strong both give the same thing, closure, which gives the phonomial algebra. Okay? And now comes something maybe don't quite explain in detail. You can embed the phonomial algebra in a much bigger algebra, which is a certain algebra of unbounded operators on L2 of gamma. These are unbound operators which are compatible with the gamma action. And if you deal with unbound operators, you have always to be careful about domains. Unbound operators are not defined on all of L2 of gamma, only on a dense subset. And so you have to think about how you add and multiply them. This is all taken care of by the theory of these von Neumann algebras of this kind, which have such a completion to, not completion, also an affiliated algebra of unbound operators. Wonderful. There is an algebraic description for this thing. So, because we want to do algebra, it's nice to have this algebraic description. Which is the order localization of n gamma at the non-zero device. So localization means you artificially introduce inverses, like we do when we pass from the integers to the rationals. We can artificially introduce inverses of integers, which were not invertible in the integers. You should be careful not to add too many inverses. So if something, an element A multiplies with another element B to zero, and you introduce 1 over A, you produce a zero ring. So rather do not this. That's why I'm avoiding the non-zero divisors as the denominators. And then there's a theorem again that this makes sense. That is, there's a certain condition to be satisfied, the Auer condition, and then we can make sense of this localization. Every element in here is formally an element of n times an inverse of an element of n, which is allowed to be taken as an inverse. Of course, then you have to think a little bit about how you add and multiply those guys, but that's taken care of by this business of Auer localizations. It's not too hard, but it uses the same method, which, I mean, the way how you show that this is really a ring that you can add and multiply uses this finite trace. And this, once you know about this finite trace, I think it's not so hard to show the Auer condition. I have to admit that a long time that I looked at the proof. So it's an exercise for you. I mean, I think you should be able to solve it. Okay, so now comes the cornerstone thing, which is this thing here. And maybe I should somehow introduce the notation also the K, but I tend not to do that. So that is contained in U gamma by definition. It is containing K gamma by definition. So we define this ring as something containing K gamma and being contained in U gamma. And how we do that? This is defined as the division closure of K gamma in U gamma. What does this mean? As we've seen here, we added a lot of new inverses. So many elements are invertible in here, which were not invertible here, and certainly were not invertible here. Division closure means each time you have, I mean, this ring should have the following property. Each time you take an element here, which is also an element here, which is invertible here, the inverse should already lie in this subring. So that's the definition of being division closed. Each time you have an inverse in the bigger thing, the inverse should be contained already here. There is one division closure which is obvious, which is U gamma itself. And then you take the smallest possible. That's a division closure. That's what you expect to be a closure. Okay, division closure is closed, undertaken inverses, and small. Wonderful. I think time is running, so I'm not introducing another ring. I could third guy here, but now I'm giving you a very cute theorem, Peter, and So following gamma should be torsion-free, so that's an important condition here, meaning that the Atiyah conjecture predicts that L2 beta numbers are always integers. Then Atiyah conjecture for K gamma, so the integrality of all these L2 beta numbers, is equivalent to an algebraic statement about the group ring, or rather this division logic in the following. Right. The division closure has to be a skew field. Algebraists would call it domain. So it's a field, but not necessarily not a commutative in general. Every element has an inverse, which is not zero. Okay, this is a, I think, is a cute result. It explains now and more and the Betti numbers. Are dimensions of modules, which are in this case some kind of vector spaces. They're classified, they're all free. And in particular, they have a dimension, a well-defined dimension, over dk gamma. So we have an explanation why we get only integers if we see this. There is some source of integrality around. These numbers are really dimensions of vector spaces, and they are, by their very definition, integers. Okay, so this is true for all torsion-free groups. Of course, this is just saying one statement is complicated and another statement is equivalent, equally complicated. But you can often use this and then get this, and it's very nice to know that one has an embedding of a ring into a skew field. And sometimes you can go the other way around and really prove the skew field property and then conclude the Atiyah conjecture. So I'm doing terribly time-wise, I guess. Yep. So. Sure. Yes. This is, I mean, yeah. I think that's a general statement. If you localize at all non-zero divisors and that's permitted, then whatever you get, you cannot get something bigger by localizing again. Yeah. Another exercise, I think, I mean, I hope at least, left to you guys in the audience. Good. So now, having seen this, the obviously, yep. Hey, U gamma is not a skew field. U gamma contains loads of zero divisors. Maybe I should give you an example, the example you all almost all have seen already. If gamma is equal to Z, we use Fourier transform to describe these things. This is what you do if you're an analyst. You always use Fourier transform if you have no other idea. And then let's say we start with the integral, the complex grouping, the Z gamma is isomorphic to the function field in one variable. And this is really the generator of Z, the integers. You caught me, because we do have a D gamma. And that is then, as you might expect, I mean, the conjecture should be true, so there should be a field extension of that coming up. And what can it be except for the function field? Okay? So, yeah, very good. Thank you. This we can think of as these are functions on the unit circle sitting inside the complex plane. And this is just the Z and the inverse, which is the coordinate of this. It's a really Laurent polynomials thought of as functions on the circle. And they sit, of course, inside bounded measure functions on the circle. So in this sense, these are Laurent polynomials that sit inside bounded measurable functions. And that is isomorphic to the Fonorman algebra. The Hilbert space, L2 gamma, is the L2 functions on the circle. And that's what Fourier transform does. And this acts by point-wise multiplication. So that's how they are operators on L2 of gamma. Of a circle, point-wise multiplication. Very well. And now we can sometimes, what is happening if we add inverses, inverses of elements in here which are not zero divisors. Being a zero divisor means you have a zero set of positive measure. Because then you can take another function which is zero outside the set of positive measure, but on it non-zero, and the product is going to be zero everywhere. Okay? So there are lots of zero divisors in here we must not divide by. We only divide by those functions which are everywhere non-zero, up to measure zero. And what we get then is just all, I don't know, L of S1, something which is never used, all measurable functions on S1. So no bound restriction. That's what you get if you divide by something which can go to zero as much as it wants. The inverse will be as big as it wants. So there's just no restriction on the functions. And these here, well, they are now rational functions. We can also think of those as functions on the circle. They do have complicated points, the poles. But this is going to be a set of measure zero, and we don't care about that in the L-infinity world. So we can think of them as certain functions on the circle. They're certainly measurable. And that's what we get at inclusion. So this is included as almost everywhere defined functions. These rational functions are almost everywhere defined, and that makes perfect sense to give this inclusion. So you see, this is never, essentially, a skew field, but it can contain inside its skew fields. In this case, everything is commutative, so it's really a field. But if the group is not commutative, this will not be commutative either. Okay? Maybe this was worth doing it. Who has seen that before? Maybe I should have asked who has not. Some have not, and they might profit from this. This is what you have in mind, should have in mind. But then there's a huge complication because groups are rarely commutative, and that really changes the picture dramatically.
Maybe just
sure.
You define the BK gamma, maybe using U gamma.
Yes.
I mean, you just define some,
would be great. So maybe new trends. define this division closure thing. Kind of intrinsically out of K gamma, and maybe also for K a finite field. We went into that a little bit this morning. This makes a lot of sense to look at these matrices of finite fields and try to make some sense of L2 Betti numbers or rank gradients or whatever, but there is no L2 available. I think it's just hopeless to think that if K is a finite field, you can bring in Hilbert space techniques at all. No one has ideas. So this is not yet a trend. It's a trend to look at K gamma for gamma a finite field, or characteristic zero field, but there are still many things missing. And one of the things which would be great would be to have this, despite we don't have the U gamma. For example, yeah? Right. So there are certain cases where you have some answers, and therefore there's hope that there could be a more general theory. On the other hand, the more general theory, I mean, by order probability, is something which you wouldn't have if gamma has torsion elements in it, for example. This is the next thing I want to address. So I guess this is a cool new trends thing we will discuss over the week, but maybe not now in this talk. division closure needs something in something where inside it what it happens. So What is division closure where exactly? Where do you close it up? I mean, the formally invert all would be this OR localization business, but that requires a condition, the OR condition, which is hard to get for, it's very hard to get, it's very rare. OR localization, so maybe this is another remark. OR localization, or, yeah, can rarely. Torsion-free amenable, and you need that it has no zero divisors to apply Tamari's result. So it's even rarer than you think, right? Can rarely be applied to K gamma. So need gamma amenable plus. Yeah. Indeed. I mean, just answering to Uli's question, who was hoping that maybe we can do a formal inversion, a formal localization procedure to get the division closure-like thing. And this is true, this can be done sometimes, but then you would think of the OR localization as the first thing you do, and this can be done rarely. Or you are more clever and you use, I think, more complicated machine, and then you need orderability of the group. Or you come up with something else, and in the case that we use the complex numbers as a ground field, this diagram is the something else we come up. But this is not applicable if K is a finite field, unfortunately. So there's a lot of questions open for that. And my question is for the case, so I want to give an answer to that as well. Question. What? Now, we still are in the case K is inside the complex numbers, so no complications of this sort. We can use the division closure, right? What about groups with torsion? And a replacement of Linnell's theorem, which we have up there. Right? In other words, a structure theorem for D gamma. I mean, I'd like to have some kind of structure theory and something like if D gamma has a kind of predicted structure, being a skew field up there, this is equivalent to the Atiyah conjecture or some kind of version of the Atiyah conjecture being true. Okay? This would be is exactly the goal I have here, algebraizing the Atiyah conjecture into properties of this division closure. And going being able to go both ways if you prove such a theorem without having a tool to prove the Atiyah conjecture in itself, because it would just be an equivalence between two properties. Well, so as you might have guessed from the abstract, which it says so, and the way I'm talking about it, we have an answer to that. So,
sorry, can I ask a question?
Of course.
Okay, Gamma, what kind of closure is it? Is it closure, strong closure, or is it?
Division closure means, let me define it. So R in S ring inclusion, which is what we have here. We have K gamma sitting inside U gamma. So small ring, big ring. The division closure of R in S is defined to be do that intersection of all T, which are subrings of S, which contain R, T. So we intersect a lot of rings inside S, starting with the full ring, but only those T. Whenever we have an element in T, such that its inverse exists in S, then the inverse has to be an element in T. Okay? No, this is, I take only those T which have this property. This is the definition of being division closed. This is closure in algebraic sense. Yeah. But it was good to ask, because this is, you can get this thing by adding the inverses, then making it a ring by adding products and sums, and then going on and doing a transfinite induction, inductive procedure. And of course, you have no hope to see what this is, apart from the case we saw with the function field. So this can always be done, and it's going to be a complete mystery in general. So in particular, this question whether it is a skew field, if you just take your favorite group and you stare at it, you will probably not be able to prove that. Okay? So this was this answer. And another question? Keep asking. Okay, so getting toward the, time where I should maybe state the theorem I want to state, although it will include some to-be-defined terms. This theorem is the replacement of Peter's theorem in the general case where we have torsion, but we want still to assume that there's a bound on the orders of torsion. So let gamma be a discrete group. Such that our famous number is finite, so we have only a bound on the orders of finite subgroups inside gamma. K should be a subfield of the complex numbers, which should be closed under complex conjugation. And if you have a ring like the integers around, you always replace the integers or this ring by the field it generates inside the complex numbers, and you will have the same beta of that field, so that is no loss of generality. Then the strong, as we had added this, center-valued Atiyah conjecture holds for gamma. So there is something about center-valued L to Betti numbers. And I guess I have to talk about that before you can understand it. If and only if the division closure with respect to this coefficient field of gamma is a precisely kind of predicted, which should give you the formulas, finite direct sum of matrix algebras determined size. So is it 5 by 5 matrices or 8 matrices over skew fields? These are mysterious, these skew fields. They are like the division closure skew fields, which are just coming up. So these things are kind of mysterious, but then I'm saying that just staring at the group, and particularly looking at its finite subgroups and the whole net by inclusion of the finite subgroups, I can make a relatively easy way, but it takes a page, one of these blackboard pages to describe it. I can describe precisely that this division closure should be a direct sum of 7 matrix rings over skew fields, one of them size 3 by 3, one of size 7 by 7, and so on and so on. This is the prediction. Let me make maybe a special case. which is kind of part of the theory for the structure, this predicted structure of the division closure. If there is no non-trivial finite normal subgroup. Well, you could have finite subgroups inside your group, but none of them is normal. That's actually probably the more typical case. This comes up. Then this division closure, I mean, the prediction is here, is predicted to be a single matrix ring over a skew field. Let me call this skew field something. Name left. I don't know. D. So that's the skew field part. And what is the size? It's this LCM of gamma. So we have just one matrix block, and the size is exactly the one we expect somehow as a famous number coming up all along. It's this LCM of gamma. So many blocks do we have. And maybe focusing on this case a tiny bit more. Then, so if we have this particular structure, and that is exactly as predicted by the conjecture, then we know that the Atiyah conjecture should hold, and so we should be able to say something about the L2 Betti numbers. And what we get then is that the L2 Betti numbers then turn out to be equal to dimensions of modules over this matrix ring, over this division closure. Now, let's think about modules over this matrix ring. Well, there's a free module, of course, which is the thing which should have dimension 1. But this is now not the smallest possible module. Who sees a smaller module around? Column vectors, right? I mean, this is, as we know it, matrices over the complex numbers have the row vectors or column vectors, depending on from which side you multiply, as a module for themselves. And if you add L of these row vectors, you get exactly something isomorphic as a module to the free module. So this breaks up as a direct sum of L things, which are all the same, namely, which are these d to the L, these row or column vector modules. So you see, and this thing here, the d to the L, is really the smallest module you can have in such a skew field matrix ring over skew field case. They are classified, these modules, as for skew fields themselves. And if this whole thing should have dimension 1, and it's broken up into L equal pieces, then each of these pieces should have dimension 1 over L. So that's why we get 1 over the LCM as the smallest possible L2 Betti number in that case. Okay. So the dimension are multiples of 1 over LCM. I screwed it up. So I've stated the theorem, which is good, but there is a little bit of leftover definitions to do. You do have an idea. I think you wouldn't really be too enlightened if I told you precisely how I get the number of these matrix blocks and their sizes. This is a good example of what is happening. But I should have told you something about the center-valued trace. And can I do this in 1 second? Second is over. So maybe you asked if you're really interested at some point, and we leave it like that now. So the Heisenberg group is a good example where what the D is, this skew field. No, unfortunately not. I mean, what do you expect as an answer? It is something like the division closure in the torsion free case of something which is completely mysterious. So it's just coming up somehow. And unfortunately, I don't have a good procedure to say this division closure is coming from some other groups, and then it's very, very much unclear. So the Heisenberg group would be one which where the special case applies to. It has no finite subgroups whatsoever, so it also so has no normal finite subgroups. Yeah. So it's really a matrix ring over skew field, but this skew field is as mysterious as, well, also it's torsion free. So this is a one by one matrix ring. So yeah. Yeah, sorry, this is even easier.
Would the center value
of the Heisenberg be for this Heisenberg? Oh, no. So the... let me look at this. The complex group ring, or this K gamma in general, has a center, as most rings have, as all rings have. So all elements in this group, which commute with every other element, multiplication, which is just functions on, so an element in here I think of as a function from the group to the complex numbers. Now these are functions not on a full group, but only on the subset of gamma of elements with finitely many conjugates. So this is a certain subset. Some elements have finitely many conjugates, others have infinitely many conjugates. If you think about what it means to be in a center, you see it can only be supported on these elements which have finitely many conjugates, and it's also constant on each conjugacy class. So this is really an easy exercise to see that this is precisely the center, and the this center is contained in the center of the Fonorman algebra, which is a bit bigger in general. For the Heisenberg group, it's definitely a bigger thing, as you described. But the and the center values, L to Betti numbers, are elements of this center. Okay, so this is something I tell you, and you can also try to work out what the center for the Fonorman algebra is, maybe for yourself. Now, the center valued Atiyah conjecture, in the first place, says that these L to Betti number, center valued L to Betti numbers, only live in here. So that's part of the statement, the first part of the statement. So for the Heisenberg group, although it has a big center, and therefore this thing is quite big, it has no if you talk about the finite support condition, which is built in here, this is only defined on finitely many elements, then there's nothing left except for the trivial group element. So the center value Atiyah conjecture predicts in particular a restriction to a very small subset, which in this case is just functions on this maximal normal finite subgroup. And then there is more conditions on what precisely, what kind of functions you get there. This is then to be worked out from like the usual Atiyah conjecture in certain integrality conditions. And maybe I can tell you something about what you expect. these are certain projectors, right? Well, these are certain projectors, period. And we should expect exactly those projectors which live in finite subgroups as BHs, and then we apply this center value trace to those. So, and then you get a certain subgroup of the center, and that generates everything you expect. So, short answer, this center value Appiah conjecture is about some mysterious center value dimension, and the prediction is you can only get values which you induce up, which are given by things which live on finite subgroups. So if there is no finite subgroup, then you only get things which live on a trivial subgroup, and that just gives you the integers. Otherwise, you have to go through all the finite subgroups, look at projectors which live in the group ring, and that gives you a certain set. You can easily compute it. It's not too hard, but it's, again, a bit hard to write down. So this conjecture is everything comes from finite subgroups.
Mm-hmm. I mean, of course, you just try to say that if you have gamma, then
Well, once again, you could have a kind of general way to understand the center of this phenomenon algebra. I certainly do need that there is a group around, and that I can, inside this phenomenon algebra or matrix over the phenomenon algebra, I can look at, suffice to be inside the phenomenon algebra, to look at projectors which are defined over finite subgroups. So inside the phenomenon algebra, I have something which is arithmetic or somehow knows something about this group, which is that there are subgroups and that there are elements which are... This gives me the projections. And there is a canonical normalization. The center value trace is canonical. So there is no... Oh, no, the integrality would then be... No, because it's a discrete set. Right. And arbitrary L to Betti numbers live in it. This is a strong statement. Yeah, then to bring in the LCM, this is by giving you some control of what you plug in. Right? If you have a bound on the orders of finite subgroups, there's only finitely many isomorphism types of finite subgroups, only finitely many conjugate Lacy classes of finite subgroups. And therefore, you get this discreteness of this possible things which come from finite subgroups for free if you have the LCM condition. So that's how it would come in. But once again, we can either be very concrete with these descriptions of these elements, which is what I like. But if you want to forget this, you still have a relevant statement. There's a certain subset of the center, things coming from finite subgroups, which you can show if you make these assumptions, is a discrete subset of this vector space with the topology. And the second statement is that all L2 beta numbers of this vast group, which is not just coming from finite subgroups, of course, still live in this subset of the center generated by those projectors living over finite subgroups. That's the prediction of the center-valued L2 Attia conjecture. It implies the classical Attia conjecture very easily. So there is a prediction of what the set is. We can describe it. And the claim is the conjecture says every L2 Betti number lives in this subset. And the,
I'm asking this.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.